Okay. Connect back with your posture, stable, centered. And then think, as it says in verse 14, even if someone broadcasts all kinds of unpleasant remarks about you throughout the 3,000 worlds, in return with a loving mind, speak of their good qualities. This is the practice of bodhisattvas. Though someone may deride and speak bad words about you in a public gathering, looking on them as a spiritual teacher, bow to them with respect. This is the practice of bodhisattvas. So just thinking about how to use disgrace, how to use disparagement on the path to enlightenment. Okay, so you can relax your attention. So those two verses, and then we'll move on to looking at the perfection of concentration as we've been doing. So just kind of orienting yourself back, 37 practices of a bodhisattva. We're in section B, the post-meditation practice of using unfavorable circumstances on the path. In particular, using on the path the four things that we don't want to happen: loss, suffering, disgrace, and disparagement. So 14 and 15 are really looking at very deep mind training. We're looking at the very deep mind training that shifts from the ordinary view that, of the eight worldly concerns is really seeking praise, seeking validation, seeking support, seeking to be seen, all of these things which are very normal and natural, we're trying to lift ourselves out of and into actually appreciating being disparaged, actually appreciating being in disgrace. Why? Right? Why do we shift into that? Because when someone points out our weaknesses, when someone tells our secrets, when someone reveals our negative qualities in public, when they do these things, they're not motivated well. They're not operating out of kindness. However, we see it as an incredible kindness, because without those moments in time, we don't have anything to push up against in terms of noticing how far our practice has gone or otherwise. So it becomes like a litmus test to check in with your own level of patience and your own level of compassion. So if you can remain stable, even when there are threats all around you, you are well-trained. And so this training in verses 14 and 15, how to use disgrace, how to use disparagement, this is really talking about when people are accurately pointing out your faults. As well as if they're saying unpleasant, untrue things, as well as if they're saying them in general, just lies unrelated to you, but are aggravating. So it's talking about a few different kinds of things here. It's talking about unpleasant words in general. What is our response to hearing what we don't want to hear? Yeah, and so I think this can be really interesting if you have probably most of us have our email inbox flooded with all sorts of extra information right now about how to cope with this situation, which may or may not be useful, which may or may not be true. Yeah, but it's like a flood of information, and there's a certain amount of it that is useful for us, and then a certain amount of it which might get aggravating. How do we respond to that? Do we feel like we need to answer every email? Do we need to address every issue? Do we get paralyzed and overwhelmed and can't answer anything or look at anything? You know, just kind of noticing what is our response when we're being communicated with in a way we don't want. So that's kind of, you know, the less personalized. And then what do we do when we're being communicated with in a way that is actively seeking to wound us? When people are pointing out our weaknesses, pointing out our flaws, pointing out our secrets, and revealing them to others or shaming us for them. You know, something that probably doesn't happen that much in an extreme way for, you know, a relatively calm adult with a not too dramatic life. But, you know, there are chapters in our life when people are speaking behind our back or speaking badly about us. Maybe professionally, maybe within the family, maybe just a small circle of friends is annoyed at a choice that you made. How do we respond when our faults are being pointed out? This is a really rich place of training, isn't it? Because one of the greatest gifts of being spoken badly about is that the object of negation roars to life and you can find it. Yeah. What is the object to be negated? The inherently existent self. Yeah, the self that does not exist at all, the not even relatively existent self, the self that we identify with as us, the pretender, shows itself when you're criticized. You think, how dare you say that to me? Or how dare you say that to me? You know, depending if we're more reactive in an angry way or more reactive in a depressive way, the reactivity point is the very self that is non-existent. And when things are easy and calm, that self is quiet. It's not causing trouble. It's not interfering with our mental peace. It's not seeming to cause dramas or conflicts with others. And so these points where we've actually had our faults pointed out to us are so valuable because you feel the eye and it feels so real. Yeah, if someone were to accuse you of something that you did 20 years ago that you're embarrassed about and you thought about and then you moved on from and now you're living your life very differently, but no one else knew about it, and now this other person is naming that thing from your past and telling everyone, it's horrible, right? It's a horrible breach of confidence. It's a horrible, unkind thing to do, and so very, very kind of them, right? Not because they intended to be kind, but because it was valuable for us. So this is this really, you know, hardcore mind training, which we are not perfect at in any stretch. But I think even just the premise of when people say things unkind about me, when they reveal my weaknesses, this is very, very valuable for me. When people praise me and validate me and tell me everything I want to hear, usually it just reinforces my pride. Usually it just makes me more confident about things I don't necessarily need to be confident about. Yeah, sometimes we need validation. Sometimes we need support and feedback. But a lot of the time, that very, you know, a compliment just flares up negative states of mind. Yeah, it just makes that illusory self seem more concrete. To constantly be flooded with praise and compliments is not useful for us, right? To be disparaged and criticized and looked down on is painful. It's so painful, but it's so rich in terms of practice and ultimately builds the kind of resilience we need to be a bodhisattva. So verses 14 and 15, you know, like the rest of the verses, this is advanced practice. This is really advanced practice, and we're not necessarily there yet. Maybe some days we are, some days we aren't. But just holding it as an ideal can really loosen up a little bit of our reactivity with the minor things of this type, with minor criticisms, with being slightly disrespected, being slightly ignored, all these little tiny wounds that we take in a conversation with people sometimes, you know, these little hits that we take when we feel like people are not seeing us or understanding us. We can start on that level of not taking things personally, even when they're personal, sure. But even more than that, what if we do take them personally, but take them as a training instead? It's something to explore, because I think without this, we really can have so much more drama and conflict in our life. And with this way of thinking, even the most obnoxious people in our life, we start to see them as valuable. So it's very much like the 8 verses that we've gone over many times. What do you think about too much, too soon? You just woke up from holiday and you're like, oh God, bodhisattvas are intense. Right.
Yesterday there was a demonstration for democracy and against all things that are threatening it. And Yoram Yovel, which is a psychoanalyst and a researcher, his speech was very in this spirit, that the people who voted are smart people and good people, and that because, and even, I mean, I don't want to say all the things he said, but that we should be, we should see them as our brothers and sisters and not our enemies. So I think it's in the same spirit that you're talking about.
Okay, we're going to switch now to page 29. Yeah. Did you want to add any more about those verses? They are really rich, pithy verses. I don't want to move on before we're ready, if you had added things.
I want to say something concerning the previous discussion, concerning the difficulty to take these experiences of being unreputed and all and insulted and so on. I think that the trap is if we are taking it as an interaction, as something which is a to and fro from me and the other person, instead of using it as a space for practicing. It's not about my relationship to him or his relationship to me. It's about the option of looking at the self arisen again. Even if I have already reached some degree of understanding, of conceptual and cognitive understanding of what does it mean, the empty of inherent existence of the I, of the self. And then I see how it's kind of a monitoring processing of knowing what am I feeling about myself when it is attacked. So it's not something that I have to deal as a dialogue or as an interaction with the other guy. The interaction might be the result of an improved practicing of myself vis-a-vis the inherent self and understanding the uninherent self. That's something that I can gain and enjoy even attacks on my reputation or status or so on.
Yeah, exactly.
I need an explanation, Anan or Yönten or someone, concerning the resilience and the not inherent existence. Like the example you were giving is something that you have to deal with. You were giving an example of narcissistic wound, wounds. So what does it mean, resilient? I'm talking about an inner conversation concerning the ultimate truth and the resilience concerning insult or whatever.
It's this process of, you ask yourself, who is being wounded? Who is being wounded? You know, you feel the wound or the narcissistic wound, or, you know, you feel like you have been attacked or you feel like you have been harmed in some way. And then the question you ask from the ultimate perspective is, who was harmed? What was harmed? And so then you explore that and you think, well, I was. And you think, okay, where? Where is that I that was harmed? Was it the I that was harmed 5 minutes ago when they said that? Did the wrong thing 20 years ago that they're saying everything about? Is it, what is it exactly that's been harmed? And then you ask, what was the harmer? Was it the words? Was it their afflictions that propelled the words? Was it their suffering that propelled their afflictions? Was it their ignorance that propelled the negative karma that led to their suffering? What actually was in charge? You know, and then you look at like the patient section in the Lam Rim, and it will say, if you're angry at someone hitting you over the head with a stick, you're not angry at the stick, even though that's what hurt you. You see what wielded it, and that's where you place the idea. So it's this idea of asking who and what harmed opens up the ultimate to you. Because when you open up the ultimate, then you realize there is no harm or harmer or harmed. The three spheres lack any intrinsic existence. And that is a relief. Your mind relaxes, and that builds resiliency. That wisdom, that knowledge builds the resilience so that the next time you're criticized, there's not a target. You know, there's nothing to strike anymore. And it's much easier to then look through the negative speech of someone else and see straight to their suffering and have the response of compassion, response of anger or self-loathing or whatever it is. Yeah, and we're remembering that it's always twofold, that there's the inner conversation and there's the outer activity. The outer activity can still be using worldly wisdom and peaceful means to prevent injustice or to address injustice, but you're starting from the inner conversation of, I'm offended on their behalf because my grasping at inherent existence has included them in the sphere of mine. There is me and then there is mine. And even if I don't know them, I have affinity with them, which is making them feel like mine. So when they are being attacked, I am being attacked, even though I don't frame it in that way. Yeah, so you're feeling some sort of, person A is hurting person B and I am connected to person B, so must address person A, when in fact it's far more interconnected than that. So if you can immediately go to the ultimate, there is no inherently existent harm, harmer, harmed, etc. Then you relax and then you can act. And the action still might be, this is relatively, conventionally, worldly harm that needs to be addressed, but I don't have an agitated mind coming to that problem solving. I don't have an agitated mind coming to that, which means I'm going to be more effective, which means my worldly wisdom is more accessible. Yeah, so you have to do the inner work so that then the outer work has more chance of effectiveness. And even if it's not effective, you still have inner peace, not destroyed. Right? So it's like the classic Shantideva verse of, what is the point in trying to cover the whole world with leather when I could just wear shoes? right? Meaning, you know, what's the point in trying to change everything outside because it agitates and hurts me? If I develop my own mind, nothing is hurting me. Which is not the same as being complacent or complicit or allowing harmful things to go unchecked. It means that you're bringing your wisdom self to the situation rather than your afflicted self. So how all this builds resiliency is just repetition. Yeah, the more times you have these conversations with yourself of who was harmed, what was harmful, the more times you have that conversation, the less it triggers you and affects you and hurts you.
It seems that you have to renounce before you can practice such a praxis. It's hard, you know. You have to renounce. If you want to be able to move from relative, that's where you were hurt, to the ultimate, you have to have this, you have to practice this first, you know, just to renounce. And then you can ask yourself, who is being harmed? Otherwise, the immediate feeling is me. What does it mean, who? For example, you gave the example with someone hits you. When someone hits you, you are not angry with the thing, but with the one who hit you, and it hurts you. So it takes time that you can move forward to say, well, it's ignorance. It's not ignorance. First of all, it hurts me, whether it's in my heart or in my body. So you have to practice a lot renunciation to be able to move between these two spheres, you know. Otherwise, when you hurt, you hurt.
Well, if renunciation that you're describing is acknowledgement that suffering has a cause, then yeah, suffering has a cause, but not the cause we think it is. We blame the conditions instead of the actual cause. But I mean, we already do this even before we met Dharma, right? Like if you're babysitting someone's little kid who's 4 years old and they say, I hate you, I don't want to go to bed. I hate you, you took my toys. You're not taking that personally. You know that they're a tired child, right? So it's not like, you know, it's not like it lands. You know, it doesn't land and it doesn't hurt you because of your background knowledge about how children are. You know, unless you're really tired that day, right? But, you know, it's like it's the same kind of mechanism within you that in quiet, calm times, you remember when you have been the harmer, when you have been the one that has said the unkind thing, who has revealed the secret that shouldn't be revealed, who has named the weakness that should be hidden, when you've broken the confidence. What drove you to that was not joy. Yeah, what drove you to that was a suffering and an affliction. And had you been happy, you would not have said it. And so then when you hear it the other direction, you go to, if they were happy, they would not have said it. This is a symptom of suffering. May they be free of suffering. You know, and we already do this with some people in our life. We just don't do it with everyone or the people that we are particularly attached to. But it's not to say we can't. It's this gradual training. Yeah, so that's, you know, using dependent arising to access resiliency and compassion. But when you use dependent arising enough, it leads you to expanding into emptiness or understanding emptiness and that space of infinite possibility, that the way we name things isn't their truth. Yeah, and the more you do that, the easier it gets, right? And so you try to find those places where you already do it just fine. And move from understanding the dependent arising and having that access compassion into something even deeper, pull dependent arising into opening into that space of infinite possibility. Because dependent arising is still living in the relative where it's saying, this happens because of this and because of this and because of this and because of this. So if I blame one thing, I'm exaggerating because many things came together for this to happen. Which is profound and useful and necessary. But if you can move even further and let that dependent arising go into almost infinite dependency, then what you're left with is the space of infinite possibility, that emptiness of nothing existing from its own side, which is a tremendous relief for the mind. Yeah, so you know, you break things into components just using your own logic, and then you realize everything has components which have components which have components, and that there is nothing standing alone. Therefore, there is nothing that is harmed and nothing to blame in and of itself. And yet, of course, harm was felt. But to come back to where did the feeling of suffering actually come from is not so simple as our afflictions say. And so whatever is going to get you into unlocking the afflictive response to suffering is the first step. And that means you have to acknowledge that there is suffering. You're not jumping over suffering or pretending there isn't the suffering. But, you know, you're immediately using the suffering and opening and opening and opening. Then the next time it happens, it doesn't hurt you as much. It's really gradual, and it's easy to do this spiritual bypassing thing that is the big danger in Dharma, which is to know where you're going and so to jump over where you are in order to get where you're going, but you're not actually there yet. It's inauthentic, it's fragile, and it doesn't work because you jumped over a whole series of thought processes to get there, because intellectually you knew where you were going. So we don't want to do this spiritual bypassing. We want to know where we're going and then compare that to where we are and see where it marries up with our own current abilities, and realize that actually we do this highest form in tiny ways in certain circumstances. Then how do we expand it? Just build on that. Start where you are. So it's like, you know, something to aim for. It makes you happy. You think, someday I'm going to be able to take disgrace on the path. I'm going to take this on the path so much so that it actually gives me joy when people point out my weaknesses. That's amazing. Today, that's not happening, but that will be amazing, you know. It's interesting. I think all of us find over time, like with the eight verses that we know a little bit more, that they might jump into your mind more frequently than they used to, just from familiarity. And they'll jump into your mind and protect you from the suffering of that moment, the more familiar they are.
The eight verses were very useful, I think. We were studying this much before we were deepening, and I had the impression, maybe I didn't understand them, but I had the impression that they are very, very helpful because they really helping you, but samsarically, what you call in condition, to see the whole picture and to change the meaning of what has happened. For example, the sixth verse, which is, you know, the person who hurt you the most is your biggest teacher, for example. So you change the meaning. So this is very helpful because you can charge it with a lot of understandings, you know, but it's not, it's within ignorance. It's not out of ignorance.
Yeah, exactly. But it's wiser than your usual relative, you know? It's wiser than you were before, even though it still has ignorance. It's wiser. Less ignorant.
Yeah. It's wiser.
And so, yeah, exactly. Exactly. And it's more spacious, and there's more possibilities, and there's more room for growth, and it's essential. That way of thinking is essential. It's profound, and it's not finished yet. You know, so that's why we're taking that and letting it lead us to the even deeper step, which is nothing from its own side, not in and of itself, which is really a huge leap, and yet is what will give you the maximum relief. It will give you the maximum relief from suffering and the maximum relief from the habit of your ignorance. So it's gradual, yeah. And the eight verses in and of themselves are incredibly profound, even from a totally secular, just let's reframe things kind of way. But remember, the last of the eight verses is talking about the ultimate. It's just gradually leading you there, gradually. So, concentration. Yeah, page 29, where it says how to meditate. So remembering that we're using the same training and concentration that we already know from previous semesters, but now we're bringing bodhicitta to it specifically. So it's bodhicitta concentration, or the perfection of concentration, which has more power than concentration on its own. Just like mindfulness in general, the mental factor of non-forgetfulness in your daily life will lead to more calm, better memory, etc., good stuff. But bodhicitta mindfulness will accumulate huge amounts of positive momentum while being self-aware. So this is really encouraging us to always have an agenda together with our concentration, to have an agenda always with our mindfulness. Because if we're doing this work anyway, we might as well do it in the most efficient way. So if you can bring the highest ideal to the simplest of practices, then the simple practice has so much more power. So it might still be that you're using a concentration method of focusing on the breath, just nice shamatha that you know and love and, you know, are functional with, but you're imbuing it with bodhicitta and it's going to have so much more power. And in a way will be easier because there's a bigger reason for it. So in a way it's easier to stay with your practice if you bring a bigger motivation to it because it's more important then. So the way that you do this is you have to kind of line up some preliminaries in your head to get you to hold still and do it properly, but also to get you to open up and do it from the biggest place. So it says, first arouse bodhicitta with the aspiration to establish all beings in the very essence of enlightenment. Then make the seven branch offering. So that's what we're going to talk about today, because you got to know how to motivation, whether it's with a prayer or a word or an analytical process, you can connect with bodhicitta. This is the next step, which is the seven branch offering practice. So if you want to jump down the page to the footnote, it's the footnote, seven branches are where there's a little star, a little asterisk. So it says seven branch offerings or seven limbs are to connect with and enhance your bodhicitta motivation, as well as to accumulate merit and purify negativities before the actual meditation session. So you're on the cushion, you know, you're sat, you know, it's like you're meditating, but you're moving your mind just through a series of steps to get yourself fully immersed in the practice, which is basically making you receptive to the very thing you seek. So, you know, the prostration physically is going to be, you know, two palms together, classic religious looking prostration. But really prostration is a mental activity. So the fundamental premise, which I think I've said to you guys many times, is that you become receptive to what you respect. Yeah, you become open to what you respect. You want to embody what you respect. And so you're reminding yourself of what you respect. When you do prostration, you're reminding yourself. Yeah. And so reminding yourself of what you respect, you can think of, you know, the Buddha specifically, or your spiritual mentor specifically, or the ideal of compassion, it, you know, just as an ideal. It doesn't even have to be personified in any way. But what you're doing is you're really engendering a deep respect for the profundity of your path. Yeah, it's in a way giving yourself some space to really own the fact that your practice is a significant thing. It's a powerful and an important thing. And so even if you're going to sit for 10 minutes or 5 minutes watching the breath, it's kind of lifting you into, this is worthwhile, right? A lot of what I do during the day is not going to have much lasting benefit unless I bring a good motivation to it. This I'm doing here and now. This is profound and different. Prostration is like a mutual prostration of respecting the quote outside transformation that you seek and the personification of that, as well as respecting your own ability to merge, respecting your own ability to transform you're respecting your own ability to hear and integrate wisdom. So to say I prostrate with my body, speech, and mind to the Buddha is really saying I can become a Buddha and I respect myself enough to engage in this path. I respect that it's been done. Therefore, that gives me inspiration to try. So prostration sounds so religious and it's very triggering, but it's very good for cutting through pride while giving you confidence. Yeah, it's cutting through pride and giving you confidence simultaneously. And so it can be a very powerful practice. Before people do a 3-year retreat, they do 100,000 prostrations in order to kind of clear the cobwebs and purify their mind so that when they do their 3-year retreat, they can really center themselves and do it deeply. Yeah, it's a very profound practice doing prostrations. But there's physical prostrations, verbal prostrations, mental prostrations, but the main one is mental. Yeah, and it's engendering a mind of respect. So thoughts and questions about that limb or that branch? I mean, it's usually in most practices, it's just one line, it's just one simple line. Reverently, I prostrate with my body, speech, and mind to all the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, or to the three jewels, Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha, or to the Guru Buddha. And it sounds like you're bowing, yeah? It sounds like you're saying, I am low and bad, you are good and high. That's the way it looks, that's the way it sounds, and that is not what is meant. That is not what is meant at all. It's really saying, you are showing me my potential, I respect that it exists out there and it exists in here. Yeah, it's a mutual respect. So, you know, when the big teachers come in and we all stand up and we prostrate, we're really prostrating to a mirror of ourself in its finished form. They don't need our prostrations, the completely internal process of becoming open and receptive. And then it has these external displays that look very subjugating or look very low or look like you're putting yourself down and putting someone else high when that's not at all what's happening. But it is subduing your pride. Yeah, which is not the same thing as disempowering yourself. It gives you more confidence to have less pride. So it's a profound practice and it can take seriously 10 seconds, 20 seconds. Yeah, the seven limb practice can, you know, be a 30-second practice before you even start your practice. It just needs a little bit of thought that the seven limbs have some meaning and some have some impact. So you have to know what they mean in order for them to be significant, because just on their own, they seem very religious and can be a little bit confusing. So questions, thoughts about prostration? Does that make sense why we do it? You don't have to do it, but does it make sense why we do it?
I want to say something concerning the connection between discipline and the tenets of your path. I frequently think of the discipline, of my commitment to discipline, as a way of showing respect to the path. So it's not only the seven limb, the sectional prostration and then the offering and so on and confession and so on. I think that the whole notion, the whole idea of commitment to discipline is a way of respecting what I'm aiming to.
Yeah, I agree 100%.
For example, we usually, we are not, when we are starting a session, a therapeutic session, we don't even think of being late to. If we are in some way has to be late, we feel it as a very empathetic failure, not only for the patient, but for myself. So I think that this is a kind of a discipline that is even, the setting is not only a framework. It's a way of respect to what we are believing in and what we are aiming to.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly that. So, you know, these processes of just kind of reconnection with the point of it all, it gives you your power back so that it becomes something a lot more long-term useful, but as well as something that builds a continuity and a momentum. So, you know, if you just think, I'm going to sit down and meditate for 5 minutes because I have a stressful day and I want to be calm, sure, good, do that. You know, do it, meditate anytime you feel like it, do it in any way you want to. But if you just say, okay, I'm tired, I'm stressed, I have 5 minutes to meditate, how about before I meditate, I just remind myself of my path and I reconnect with it, and then I meditate for 5 minutes, it's a much more powerful 5 minutes. Yeah, and it builds a more a stronger urge to do more and to do again and to repeat and to do it even when it's difficult, because there's a big enough reason for it, you know? So the second limb is the limb of offering. And this is, again, just to reconnect with respecting something. Then a show of respect is to offer something you find valuable. The main benefit is to yourself and to your own practice, right? So I'm offering these lights and these water bowls. The Buddhas don't need the light. The Buddhas don't need the water bowls. They will love me and try to benefit me till the end of time, even if I never give anything ever. It's about me becoming more receptive to the representations of my path. And so I'm going to offer something that is easy to offer and valuable, right? So water is incredibly valuable. Water is incredibly precious, but it's easy enough to access for us. These lights are easy enough to access for us, but we know the importance of light, of warmth, of fire. So these things are not important in and of themselves. They become good offerings because I value them. So if I don't value them, they're not a good offering. You know, sometimes people say, what shall I bring to puja? Puja is a religious ceremony. And what offerings should I bring for the altar? And I always say, if it's delicious for you, it's a good offering, right? If it's something you find desirable, it's a good offering. Because it's also helping you look at your own attachment and start moving along the path of transformation. Here's this delicious chocolate that I very much want, so I'm going to give it. Yeah. And then once you've given it, it is a circuit breaker for your attachment. You separate yourself from your attachment, and then you wind up eating it yourself afterwards without attachment. Yeah. So it's an interesting process, because the very things you offer, you also wind up receiving. Yeah, so you offer, this is, again, can be completely mental, or you can, you know, get a little flower from your garden and place it on the altar and think, this represents the open heart of compassion, which is the best offering I could possibly give. Whatever, right? There's a lot of different kinds of offerings you can do, but the main one is mental. So you just think, I offer everything beautiful I can imagine to the representations of my path. Yeah, 5 seconds, 10 seconds. And then you move on to confession, which is basically having a mind of self-honesty. It's a mind of self-honesty that is willing to expose your faults at least to yourself, but you're exposing your faults to yourself under the gaze of the representations of your path. So then you're not humiliated, you're held. Yeah, you're held in this compassionate gaze, which means you can confess to anything, because the representations of your path are not going to judge you harshly. They know every reason for everything you've ever done. So how do you do a quick confession if it's only a few seconds? You just think, physically, what am I getting up to that is not in alignment with my path? Verbally, what am I getting up to that is not in alignment with my path? Mentally, what am I getting up to that is not in alignment with my path? Just so far today, or just recently, this last week or two, what am I getting up to? Yeah? What are the behaviors that are out of sync with how I want to live? Let's just name them and recognize them as faults. Because again, that breaks the circuit, or it breaks the momentum of those negative things just by seeing them. Yeah? You might have just, I don't know, went on a whole rant about some political figure that you're annoyed with, and you just, you know, raved for 10 minutes to your partner or your coworkers about how much you're annoyed with this political figure or that political figure. And now you're sitting and you realize some of that was information sharing, some of that was connecting, and a lot of that was divisive and anger-based and not helpful. Right, that's not in alignment with my path. Recognized. So it's not a guilt trip, right? It's not a shame flood. It's just a, oh, right, I slipped off track. Yep, when I get up off this cushion, I'm realigned. I'm recentered, I'm reconnected. So I can stay with my path better once I get off this cushion. So you're confessing under the gaze of the objects of your refuge. Then you're rejoicing, right? So this is the antidote to jealousy. But first, it's this way of maximizing the positive that you're doing. So just like with confession, you're thinking, all right, today, so far, physically, what has been positive? Verbally, what has been positive? Mentally, what has been positive? All of that is worth celebrating and acknowledging, because then I'll do more of it. I'll have more energy for it. I'm re-recognizing its benefit. I'm giving my path back to myself. I'm seeing that already today I've done so much that is in alignment with my ethics. That is something to celebrate. And then you think about the people around you also doing wonderful work. Right? We talked about this rejoicing practice when we did the four immeasurables, and we talked about immeasurable joy from the Sanskrit tradition. That this practice of rejoicing, you start with yourself, then the people you know, including the people you don't like, then generally people you know of doing positive work, and then people practicing in a spiritual way or in a deeper way, and then all the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas. So you're just doing this exponential rejoicing, which lifts you out of the world's going to hell and there's nothing we can do about it, right? It can shift that. But it's also giving your path back to yourself, realizing there's a lot good that you're already doing. Yeah, so rejoicing. And then the request to stay, you're requesting the representations of your path to stay, to create the cause for them to stay. Yeah? Then you're requesting them to teach, to create the cause for them to teach. So there's a lot of this in Buddhism of you don't come somewhere or teach somewhere unless someone asks you to. If they ask you to, it's showing that there's a receptivity, right? You're not going around giving psychoanalysis to random people on the street. You're only giving it to the people coming into your office because they're requesting it, right? Because there's an openness for it. So what we're trying to do is create the cause to keep meeting teachings that we love, to keep meeting the embodiment of our path, whatever that might be. So we request to stay, request to teach, and then we dedicate this very tiny practice that we've just done, you know, 30 seconds, 1 minute of, to the highest enlightenment, and then watch your breath. Yeah, then watch your breath. And you're just watching your breath, right? No big deal watching your breath. You don't have to think about anything else while you're watching your breath. You're not adding anything to it. It's just now it's qualified. It's imbued by these previous thoughts. It's got more strength. So this is the seven limb practice. If you haven't done that Shakyamuni Buddha meditation, if you could at least look at it once, so you have a sense of it. The seven limbs are elaborated in their traditional form in that meditation. And then you can secularize it or personalize it in a way that seems to resonate with you. But it's worth experimenting to do just a very normal short meditation that you've done many times, but to add this in front of it and just see what happens. Just see what happens. So questions about the seven limbs or ideas about it?
Can you explain a little bit more the five and six, the request to stay and the request to teach?
Yeah, Well, I mean, in the traditional form, you're saying, please remain until the end of cyclic existence. Please continuously turn the wheel of Dharma. That's the traditional prayer version. But you're basically saying, may there be things that inspire me to transform and progress. May there be ways to access the tools for that transformation. Because the thing is that inspirational people and meaningful tools already exist, right? But for us to notice them, for us to access them, we need to be thinking about it, right? So before you met any kind of path of any kind, paths existed, but you didn't have any connection to them until you started looking. So this is about just kind of keeping the mind of a seeker. It's keeping the mind of a seeker so that when wisdom enters into your sphere, you notice it, you recognize it, and you take it on board, right? So please remain until the end of cyclic existence. Guru, Buddha, Buddhism, Bodhisattvas, ideal of compassion, whatever it is, you're saying, I'm looking for that. This is what I want. This is what I respect. I'm looking for it, which means you'll see it, right? It's not like it wasn't there before you requested. It was there, but now you're going to notice it. And what's more, you want to ask it for teachings and tools, which means you will see teachings and tools. They were already being given, but now you'll notice. So there's a lot of practices that have like invoking the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, like, please come here now. They're already here, right? They already are here, they have been here. But when we do these practices, we're again removing obstacles to feeling connection. So that's a lot what these two are about, 5 and 6. And we'll just take a minute and settle and reconnect. Thanks, guys.